You're listening to the Sisters in Loss podcast, a faith-based grief and loss podcast for Black women, where you will hear stories of miscarriage, infant loss, stillbirth, and infertility to learn there is a testimony in tragedy. You will learn how to heal, gain clarity, find hope and peace, and turn your pain into your purpose after loss. I'm your host, Erica M. McAfee.
Welcome to episode 97 of the Sisters in Loss podcast. Recurrent pregnancy loss is defined as three consecutive losses prior to 20 weeks gestation. Today's guest, Tori Alamaze, knows all about recurrent pregnancy loss, as she has carried and birthed four babies, but only has one living child here on earth. In today's episode, Tori shares her journey to motherhood after receiving a vaginal cerclages and having them fail at 24 weeks with her son Issa and at 21 weeks with her boy-girl twins. She knew she needed to research to understand what was happening to her body, and she found abbyloopers.com. From her research, she knew she would be a great candidate for a trans abdominal cerclage. And in this episode, she takes us back on that journey to making the decision to undergo major abdominal surgery prior to conceiving to have her rainbow baby girl. This episode is for you to listen to if you have experienced recurrent pregnancy loss and want to understand more about cerclages and trans abdominal cerclage. Here is Tori Alamaze.
Thank you, Tori, for being on the podcast.
It's a pleasure. I'm happy to do this.
So I'd like to begin the podcast with you sharing a little bit about yourself and what you do.
Okay. Well, I am Tori Alamaze. I am an ATA lead. Okay. That's different from being from Atlanta. I am a part of Atlanta culture. And I moved to DC, Washington, DC about 4 years ago with my husband and my daughter, who is now three. And I do a lot of different things, and I'm what you call a multi-potentialite. And a multi-potentialite is defined as someone with multiple disciplines and skill sets. I started out as a professional makeup artist, background singer, performer, songwriter, singer, author, writer, and social entrepreneur. One of my current initiatives are I have a website called loudsilencebrand.com. which is my brand called Loud Silence. And one of the things that I recently did in DC was an event called Music, Life, Lipstick, and Coffee. And it literally is a cause with aesthetic. I like to bring together idea starters, visionaries, and cultural enthusiasts. And I'm a huge, huge supporter of ideas. I love supporting ideas and creating an environment and a space for ideas to cross-connect, cross-intersect, so grander possibilities take place. Oftentimes, when people have ideas, they get stuck or the how is overwhelming. So I love creating a space where the dots are being connected and you're able to go from step one to step two and so on and so forth.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I love that. So take us back on your journey to motherhood and share with us your loss story.
Oh, my. Well, it started for me in 2007. I found I was pregnant, and I actually was shocked, but quickly accepted. When I found out, I was probably 3 months, and I accepted really quickly that I was having a son. Wrapped my head around it, and it was fine. And then shortly after, I saw that I had some discharge. I'll go back a little bit. I have a brother who is 26, and he was born at 6 months. I was there. And I remember how tiny he was. I was there when my mom's water broke. I was there when she had to go into the hospital. I was the whole time. So I remember him just being born and tiny and having to be in NICU for a while, but he turned out excellent. He was fine. So when I was 6 months pregnant and I had to be on bed rest in the hospital, it actually was kind of fun. I had on a cute little gown. I made sure I brought my own little gowns, and I had magazines, did my toes. My friends came to visit. It was fine. I thought that I would just have a baby early, just like my mom, and we would be in NICU. And even when the doctors came in, I was having contractions, didn't know it was contractions, but they said the baby has to come out. I just still thought that, oh, he'll just, he'll just be in the queue and he'll be born early, just like my brother. And that was, what, 24 years ago? This was 7 years ago when this happened. So I said, oh, he'll be fine. And when he didn't take a breath, I think I just don't remember what happened next. I just recall hearing my mom screaming in the hallway, and the doctor, who I got really close to, just was really shook by what happened. And we were told that the next pregnancy would require a transabdominal cerclage. No, not transabdominal, I'm sorry, a regular cerclage, which is a vaginal cerclage. Because with the first, my first pregnancy, when they saw that I was, I can't remember the proper term for it. It's not dilating, but I can't remember the term.
They typically call it like funneling of your cervix. I also had a cerclage. So it's like your cervix is starting to funnel, like it's starting to soar and funnel. Yes. Exactly. Mm-hmm.
And that was, this was my first time at the rodeo. I was learning this language and all this stuff. And I was pregnant and it was an emergency. I was funneling. So you have to have a vaginal cerclage while you're pregnant. So I still thought, oh, well, I'll just have this cerclage and I'll just be on bed rest, take it easy, and I'll have a baby. And I had a baby via C-section, but he never took a breath. And so the next pregnancy, they said, well, you have to have a cerclage at 12 weeks. So 2011, we found out we were pregnant. We found out it was a boy and a girl. And twins don't run in my family. So I was thinking, oh, my God, we are being blessed. We lost our son and we're having a boy and a girl. Oh, my gosh. Went to the hospital for a regular checkup at maybe 20 weeks. And it was, okay, you only have to have a second cerclage. I already had one at 12 weeks. So, okay, I had to have a second one. And you have to be on bed rest to the point where I had a wheelchair in the house. It was literally shower, in the wheelchair, in the bed, sitting down. At some point, it was progesterone shots. It was Trendelenburg's, which means you're upside down in the bed. It was magnesium. It was everything, everything. But at that point, I didn't mind. It was really uncomfortable. Inconvenient, but to me, it was, you want to have to just acquiesce to these babies, like they are taking over and it's okay. So we literally had in the hospital room pictures of boy, girl babies, just so we can just visualize them being here. And I went into labor, and even in the labor, I had never experienced labor. And I tell you, it's traumatic. It is traumatic. I tried to hold them in as much as I could until I couldn't. I lost a liter of blood. They told me that my daughter was up higher and that she would probably stay in longer. But after my son came out, then she followed and then they didn't take a breath. And it just was, I don't know. I don't remember what I did, but I just remember, I don't know if it was the next day, they put me on a different floor so that I wouldn't hear the cries of babies. I felt forsaken. I felt like God just said, fuck you, just excuse my language. But it was just like, I just felt like, I mean, like I didn't get it. I didn't get it because I felt like I gave it my best. I gave it my absolute best and still. And if I remember feeling like three babies, you have to cremate three babies. And I remember this older guy came into the room. I was just done. I was just sitting there, just done. He was not my doctor. He was a doctor at the hospital. He was just sitting in a chair, quiet. And then he said, have you ever heard of a transabdominal cerclage? I said, no. And he said, I have a patient who lost three sets of twins. And I sat up. I said, you mean she lost six babies? Oh, gosh. When he said that, I was like, oh my gosh, I lost three. She lost six. And then he said, then she had this transabdominal cerclage. I said, Apollo. And he said, I'm listening, thinking like, is he going to say? And I said, did she have a baby? He said, she had two. And I really sat up and I just had some hope. I had a slight breeze of hope. And he said, I only know one old doctor who does this procedure in all of Georgia. I don't know if he's retiring soon. But all I heard was transabdominal cerclage. The lady lost six babies and she had two after those losses, after this procedure. I went home, of course, with a broken, broken heart. But I just got on the computer and just started doing research. And it led me to a community called Abby Loopers. And I started to read stories about women who've had preterm births just like I did. It led me to a particular doctor in Chicago, Dr. Haney. and I set up a consultation call. He called, he spoke to us for 45 minutes, and it was really the first time that I had some hope. I always felt like I was strong physically. I was capable. I was just trying to figure, puzzled, like, why is my body not cooperating? Why am I losing baby? What kind of cervix do I have? Why is it not working? I've never heard of this before, incompetent cervix. Everything else is strong. I've been working out all my life. I'm healthy. What is the problem? And so he said, it's really not you. It's something that you're born with the cervix. In your case, had you had one baby, not two, with the vaginal cerclage, you might have gone the whole time because it was two. That was just a lot on your cervix. So I just dug into consultations with doctors, finally got a different OBGYN. I was thinking of, I had no problem getting pregnant. So I thought maybe if I get pregnant and I can get a higher stitch cerclage, which is, I think it's the McDonald's cerclage. Met with the doctor, she said, in your case, I think that if you get pregnant and you get a higher place cerclage, you're still going to have a high level of bed rest. And in your case, I think you're going to be worried the entire pregnancy. So I think you're a fantastic candidate for the transabdominal cerclage. I got my womb checked for blockages, for scarring, for fibroids. I was free of them all. So that ruled out any other possible causes. And I was a fine candidate for this procedure. So my OBGYN, which was Dr. Jackie Walters, who had just started being on Married to Medicine, and found Dr. Kevin Gomez at Northside Hospital. And they called me and we set a date for September 2012. And I had my transabdominal cerclage, which is major surgery. And it's recommended prior to getting pregnant. And once I had the transabdominal cerclage in place and my hormones were regulated, I got pregnant probably a year and a half later. And I had the same pregnancy that Dr. Haney in Chicago told me that I would have. You can do everything you've always done. You don't have to be on bed rest. It was the perfect pregnancy. Perfect. And I had, for the first time in my life when I was pregnant, you always hear about pregnant women having the sciatica. I had one moment where I had the sciatica come all the way down to my leg. When I tell you, and I was by myself, my husband was traveling. I live in D.C. It wasn't any family around. I felt like if after all that I have gone through, I can breathe through this like I do everything else. I don't panic. It was just, okay, let me just stand here and breathe. I even have the UPS man drive up and he saw me standing there with this belly, my dog, and I'm just standing there and I'm like, you need help? I'm like, nope, I'm just going to breathe. And I called my mom. I called a nurse. She told me what to do, like with some cold water and some hot water, and really just followed instructions. And a couple of hours later, I was fine. So my losses, in my opinion, gave me the kind of strength that I knew I had, but it hadn't really been, what's the right way to describe it? It hadn't really been tested that way. But now I just breathe through it all. I breathe through everything because I know that there's another side. You'll get through to the other side. Just trust the process, trust the journey, breathe, and you'll be okay. And that's absolutely it.
Today's podcast episode is sponsored by Living Waters Doula Services. Out of her belly will flow rivers of living water. Rivers carry life and bring it forth to those who need it. I am excited to begin offering Living Waters Doula Services to my sisters-in-law. What is a doula? A doula is a non-clinically trained support person who provides emotional, physical, and informational assistance before, during, and after childbirth. My goal as your doula is to help you heal, remove anxiety and fear, and find peace and hope on your infertility and pregnancy journey. If you are currently trying to conceive and would like fertility support, if you are currently pregnant after loss, or if you want grief support for your recent loss, I'm available to share space with you as your doula and support you on this journey. For more details about Living Waters Doula Services, visit ericammcafee.com/doula. That is ericammcafee.com/doula. I'm excited to share space with you.
Yeah, 7 years. And then we have my daughter December 21st, 2014.
such a blessing. Thank you for taking us on that journey with you. And the woman I think you're referring to has been on the podcast. Her name is Tanika Diller. She's out of South Carolina. Her episode is, I think, episode 19, way in the beginning of the podcast, where she shares her story and her book, I guess, Building a Family She Never Knew or something like that is the name of her book. But all that should be linked in book recommendations and things in my show notes on that episode. So if you all want to go back and listen to Tanika's episode that she was referring to and then come back and finish listening to this episode. So I'm thank you for sharing that. Tanika's story is amazing and so is yours. Thank you for sharing all of that. So take us back on the part of your journey. You know, you really struggled. You talked about your struggle with God and how God was, you know, after each of the losses, you had kind of going back and forth with God, like, why me? Why you're taking me through this journey? So take us back on that part of your journey and really how your faith played a role in you still continuing pressing forward and trying to get answers. Because I think when people go through, you know, years and years and years of losses, of recurrent pregnancy loss, same thing with infertility issues, it really takes a toll on your spirit and you God is not listening to you. He's not hearing you. So take us back on that part of the journey. Really tell us how your faith really played a role as you were continue to persevere on and continue to be resilient and move through the next phase of your journey to motherhood.
Well, I remember two things in particular that stood out. A, I didn't want anybody to feel sorry for me. I didn't want anybody to feel sorry for me. Please don't feel sorry for me. I did not want pity. I did not want pity. Second, I remember listening to Donnie McClurkin's Stand. And I'm so not religious, not your typical religious, but the words stood out for me. When you do the best that you can, all you can do is stand. And I knew that, especially pregnant with my twins, oh my gosh, I gave it my best, my absolute. When my daughter came out, after my son came out first, no breath. When my daughter came out, before she came out, I said out loud, my husband didn't even, he told me all of this later. I didn't even know I was in this space. He said, I kept saying, I'll give you my last breath. Just breathe, Aza. I will give you my last breath. So I gave up my body. I was willing to give up my life. I did everything. I breathed through the horrible contractions, the kind of pain. Even when I had, before they were born, I had a scare and they told me I was going to have them that day. I said, no, I'm not. I breathed through the most horrific kind of contractions of pain I have never felt in my life. But I breathed through it because I knew it wasn't time. So when I heard the song, and when you do the best you can, all that's left to do is stand. That was all. That's what I held on to. It was just stand, Tori, because you gave it your best. It's nothing left to do. It's nothing left to do. You gave it your best. And then that's when I decided to write a letter. I wrote them a letter. And when I tell you the tears, even now, when I reread the letter, I was invited to speak at a hospital, the hospital where I gave birth to my daughter last year for Infant Loss and Awareness Month. And I was surprised I got through the letter. But the people that after I read the letter, the audience, not one dry eye, but it freed me. It freed me. And I felt like my children gave me permission to move forward. And I found in the letter that I thanked them. Like, I thank you for choosing me. Like, I know what it feels like to love. I know what it feels to have you move inside of me. I know what it feels like to have your kick. I know what it feels like to love the way a mother loves her child, even though I don't have anyone to hold or to feed. But I know that love, and I would have never known it without them existing inside of me first. So I just thank them for that. They had to go on to another assignment, and they knew that I would be okay. And that was the end. That was it for me. That was like the closure. That was the stamp for me. After that, I went into the business of research, possibility. What are my options? And then literally once I went into that phase, things really divinely lined up for me. I didn't seek out Dr. Jackie Walters. It literally was a chance situation, a chance meeting. This person called this person, and these were strangers. This person connected with this person. I thought I had to go. We were prepared to fly to Chicago with this one doctor who was specific in doing this transabdominal cerclage around the country, Dr. Haney. And we were like, okay, we have to go to Chicago. We'll recuperate here. We'll, you know, all of these things that was in place. Dr. Jackie Walters found, she said, no, Dr. Kevin Gomez at Northside. He's the doctor that does it here in Atlanta. I didn't know that. I thought it was the old man. One old man was about to retire. So that's how everything happened. It really was divine. It really was. I started doing yoga. I had my twins May 14th, 2011. I started doing yoga June 19th, 2011. And it was the beginning stages, another part of my healing. My yoga teacher, when I told her I was ready to get pregnant again, she said, well, come in 30 minutes earlier. We're going to do some fertility poses. So I started doing fertility poses a little bit earlier, and I went to an acupuncturist. And I tell anybody who wants to be pregnant, go to an acupuncturist that don't speak English. Because that's, well, that's for so me. Go to one that don't speak English, because that's that real, authentic healing. He gave me some pills. It was in Korean. I didn't know what it was, but he said three times a day. He told me to stop drinking green tea. It has cold character. He told me when I'm sitting down, put a heating pad in the chair on the couch, because you want to warm up that air. You want the blood to be warm in that area. I did all of those things, and I swear I was pregnant in less than a month. In less than a month. So I would say between the yoga, my mindset shifting and accepting that my children chose me to come through, that they was not meant to be here in the physical space, that the yoga, that acceptance, and then going to an acupuncturist, it was all in alignment. Everything was in alignment. Even me being pregnant, I was about 9 weeks pregnant, went to Dr. Jackie, and I had some spotting. I didn't even tell my husband. We went out to lunch after that, and I was just really quiet. He was like, you okay? I was like, yep, because I was processing, because I was about to be really pissed and say, God, if this child is not for me, how dare you bring this child into my body? Like, I refuse to be excited. I refuse to be happy, because I'm like, if this child is not supposed to be here, like, let me know so I can be detached. I said a heartfelt prayer that night. It's about 12 midnight. And it was just me crying, me saying, I really do love this child. I don't want to be detached from this child. But if you're going to take this child from me, then let's get it done and over with. You know what I mean? Like, let's just get it done with. I went to sleep. Next day, about 7 a.m., I was going through my Facebook timeline, and nobody knew I was pregnant. I was only 9 weeks. And I still have this text. I wish I could have pulled it up. But a friend of mine wrote, whoever this is for, a baby is coming your way. And she wrote a few other lines. And I was like, oh my God, a new baby is coming to you. God has not forsaken you. God has not forgotten about you. And when I looked at the timing of it, it was the same time I was doing my prayer. It was the same exact time I was doing my prayer. I showed my husband. He said, that's your answer. You have nothing else to worry about. And from that day forward, at 9 weeks, I was not worried about anything. I wasn't worried. And then I actually looked back, and I was going to send this to a mom today. I spoke to a woman a few days ago, because she's had several losses this year, miscarriages. And I spoke to her, I think it was Sunday. But I wrote a note to myself on my phone in the notes app. And it said, it was in February 15th. I was not married or any, I wasn't asked to be married, nothing. And it said, you're going to have a baby November 2014. Congratulations. I got married March 21st, and I had my baby December 21st.
Wow.
It's almost like you have to be out of your mind. Like, I just, between the yoga, it's like, it's really kind of woo-woo, I guess. But for me, after you cremate three babies, you can't think rationally. You just can't. The writing that note to myself, like, it literally was, you're having a baby by the end of this year. But I said November 2014. I was very specific, but that meant I would have to be pregnant like February or March. I didn't get pregnant till I found out we was pregnant 2 days before Mother's Day. That was May. And her due date was January 2015. She came 9 months to the day of when we got married. 9 months. And we had a Nigerian dancer do a fertility dance at our wedding. We had a lot of juju going on. A lot of juju going on. And that was it.
Wow. Awesome. Awesome. Yes. I definitely worked in all of that and told you by proving to you exactly what he is capable of, which is amazing. So let's talk about any other resources and tools. I know you mentioned a foundation earlier that you was connected with. Any other resources or tools that you use to help you on your healing journey?
Yes. Let me just, before I go there, I actually am looking at the actual note that I sent to myself. It was February 15th, 2014, at 4:54 p.m. It said, "Thank you for this gift of carrying my healthy baby full term, born in November 2014. That's what I said to myself. So that was it. So as far as, I think in my case, for being diagnosed with IC or incompetent cervix, I know there's so many other things and challenges that women have. In my case, it was abbyloopers.com, because once I found that community, I got all the information that I needed. I didn't have fertility challenges. So if it was fertility issues, I didn't navigate in that space. Mine was more incompetent cervix diagnosis. So the abbyloopers.com website was the best place for me to get all of the information that I needed. And it led me down a rabbit hole of other spaces that could help give me what I needed.
Absolutely. So what encouraging words can you leave with the mom out there who has had an incompetent cervix or just recurrent pregnancy loss as they begin the process of trying again?
Literally just talked to a woman the other day. Today is what, Wednesday? We talk Sunday. And I think she had 3 miscarriages this year, like back to back. And the common bond that we had was, she'd been with her spouse for 10 years, I think maybe 12 years. And I said, I was with my spouse for 10 years before we had our daughter. So she felt better about that, because I didn't want her to feel like time was being wasted. I said, we were together 10 years before we had our daughter and before we got married. So she felt the same things I felt in terms of God forsaking her, her body not working. I told her, again, it might sound woo-woo to some people, but when we lose babies, you don't think the same. So for me, I literally wrote a letter that started with, "Dear cervix." I wrote a letter to her because I needed her cooperation. And I needed her to understand we were on the same team. I needed her to understand that we are in agreement. And I just wanted her to know that we're together. We're a team. I wrote her a 1-page letter starting with, "Dear cervix." So I suggested to her, you write a letter to whatever organ, whatever issue that's failing you at this time. Because a lot of our issues, sometimes it's mental. Sometimes we're not understanding, you know, those blocks, where it comes from. It's not always medical. It's sometimes like we can heal ourselves with our mind and mindset shift. So I think the yoga and writing a letter to my cervix was all a part of that healing process, to the point where even when I moved here and I had to find a new team, and I remember the doctors, "Oh, you're high risk, and because of your age and because of, we have to do this test and that test and this test." I was not the same girl the first time I had this loss. I was much more mature and understand. I said, I had to stop everybody. I said, "Listen, I understand all your medical degrees, but this is not my first time at the rodeo. I've written a letter to my cervix and we are in agreement. We're going to have a full term healthy baby. You're going to get 1 test, 1 blood test, and that's it. We're good." And that's how I had to talk to these people. "You're not going to scare me like you do everybody else after a certain age point. I've already been through enough." They listened to me. They did 1 test, called me a few weeks later. "You are absolutely correct. Your baby is healthy and it's a girl." I'm like, I told you, we're good. I really believe that. I believe that my cervix was in agreement. I believe that after I had this trans abdominal cerclage, all would be well. And so that's the advice I will give people. Write a letter to your body. Write a letter to your heart. Write a letter to your baby. A lot of times women want to skirt over it. Or did you name your child? Say their name. Honor them. And that will be the best advice that I will give. Those are the things that I did. I always say my children's names. I thank my children. I called on them to bring forth their sibling. "I need your assistance. I need all of the ancestral energy to bring forth this child." My daughter knows her sibling's name. I can't believe when I first came out with my story that the amount of women, that even ones that I knew and were close to, never shared with me that they had losses. Why is this a secret? Why are we in shame? Why do we feel less than as women? And I don't want women to feel that way. So call on your baby's name. Write a letter to your body part, whatever's failing you. Write a letter. Trust yourself and the doctors, but trust you. I had to literally tell these doctors, this is what we're going to do, okay? And when I tell you what, my daughter will be 4 December 21st, I still produce breast milk. She never gets sick. She's 3 and can count and count to 10 in 4 languages, say hello and bye. And I get a lot of little, sometimes you get comments about, oh, you still got breast milk? Oh, you still, I sure do. I don't know why, but my answer is always abundance is mine. That's it. I feel like my daughter is magical. I do. I really, really do.
She definitely was a gift. And she has her guardian angels in heaven watching over her. That's such a blessing. I love what you said about the ancestors. I always think about the great cloud of witnesses and that are all looking down on us and just guiding us as we go through our lives. So, yeah, I love that. So where can we find you on social so that we can stay in contact with you after the podcast interview?
I have, again, multiple skill sets. So also, when you mentioned a book, I released my first children's book. It's called The Soil is Good. The Soil is Good. It's my first children's book. And I had my first signing at Barnes & Noble in 2016. And that book is describing how the subconscious mind works, but in a child's language using seed and soil. And you can find me on IG at The Soil is Good for more information on that book. And I have another book coming out called Women in Wisdom, Stories to Empower Our Girls, which is a collective of stories of quotes from women sharing their journeys, sharing their stories. And that'll be out spring next year, 2019. You can always find me anywhere at Tori Alamaze on IG. You can find me at www.loudsilencebrand.com. I'll say that again, www.loudsilencebrand.com. If you really want to know who I am, go to loudsilencebrand.com because that'll tell you who I am, period. And that's it. You can get, you'll see my storytelling, my journaling, my website. It'll take you to tree braids. It'll take you all of who I am and what I do and why it all makes sense and why it works. Even my call, one of the other initiatives is using my story, using the light and the dark. I have to use this part of my life because it was the most transformative part for me, the most magical part because it was the darkest. But that's where I feel I transform. And transforming to my best and highest self. And I want to give it away. I want to offer it to other women, other people. So my initiative is creating a foundation for women diagnosed with IC that are vetted for the trans abdominal cerclage, which is an extremely specific procedure. I want to not only raise awareness for women diagnosed with incompetent cervix, but money to give to women who, once they have this surgery, they can realize their dream of having their own family. This is the kind of procedure you must have prior to pregnancy, which means you have already experienced preterm birth. But once you have this surgery, there's a much, much higher chance of you carrying full term and having a healthy baby. So if I can help women with that, my job is done. My job is done.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Tori, for sharing your story and all the work that you do and are going to do around incompetent cervixes. It's near and dear to my heart because I've experienced the same thing. So thank you so much for being on the podcast.
Thank you, Erica, for having me. I really, really appreciate you and the work that you do as well, offering support and ear to women who suffer like you have, like I have. So job well done to you too, sister.
Thank you so much for listening to today's episode. I pray that this show was inspirational and a blessing to you. For show notes, visit ericaandmcafee.com/podcast. Please join us in our offline discussions and our private Facebook group by going to sistersinloss.com. If you're listening in Apple Podcasts, please rate and subscribe to us and leave us a 5-star review. I pray that you all have a blessed week. Keep the faith, and I'll talk to you next Wednesday. Thank you so much for listening to today's episode. I pray that this show was inspirational and a blessing to you. For show notes, visit ericaandmcafee.com/podcast. Please join us in our offline discussions in our private Facebook group by going to sistersinloss.com. If you're listening in Apple Podcasts, please rate and subscribe to us and leave us a 5-star review. I pray that you all have a blessed week. Keep the faith, and I'll talk to you next Wednesday.